Ed, who was here last year on the main stage, and Jeff, who was here 2 years ago, for those of you who were with us then. Sarah mentioned, Jeff's the CEO of LinkedIn, and Fred is a longtime friend, author of Conscious Business, and also now vice president at LinkedIn. So we're here to talk a little bit about their relationship and their vision of business and what they're doing at LinkedIn. I think what's partly so curious is when Jeff was here 2 years ago, he mentioned Fred as a deep kind of important person in his life. And then when Fred was here, he also mentioned Jeff as a deep important person in his life. So we're going to bring them together and to see what happens.
First time.
And Jeff said, as we were walking up here,
we've never done this before.
No, we've never done this before. And I was like, that's actually what makes it somewhat exciting.
Who knows how this is going to go?
So I actually wanted to start off the first question, which is just, how did you guys connect, and what is it that drew you together, and what is it that drew you about the other person?
Want to start? Because you got hired for a gig.
I was asked by Yahoo to help their executives develop some leadership skills, and that started with a...
We needed a lot of help.
That started with an assessment, and Jeff was one of the senior leaders at Yahoo that I did the assessment. And through that assessment, we got to know each other, and we spent some time after in other conversations, and we just got into some very deep discussions about the nature of business and what was the opportunities to create consciousness, really, in the business world, even though we hadn't connected about that before. And it was very fateful that some of the things we discussed very early in our relationship were the reasons why I could not refuse the invitation that Jeff made me and the challenge that he issued to work at LinkedIn. And when I said, I'll work for you, he said, no, work for the mission. And that was that's the sign of why I work for him and the mission, or the mission through him.
And was there a particular quality about you that him that connected, or was it just kind of his general?
I was just impressed, and I'm still impressed by his ability to wield power cleanly. There are not a lot of people that can wield power and be straight and clean and ethical with that. Just like the Lord of the Rings, the ring of power tends to corrupt most people.
I'm gonna do a golem impression.
Tends to corrupt most people, and it was shocking to me to find an executive that was like Jeff, and I admired him. I mean, I since I met him.
How about?
So for me, I've worked in companies where they've brought in external consultants to do various projects, and historically, when it came to talent development, I think I was particularly skeptical. You know, it's hard to scale that stuff. It's hard to understand the needs of the individuals around the table, especially when you're trying to do that at scale in an organization with thousands of people. And when we did work with Fred as a group, as a leadership team, there was something completely different about his approach, his energy, his wisdom, the way he went about communicating with us. And it was really quite unique, and that's how we met. And the friendship and the professional relationship continued to evolve. And as we talked about a couple of years ago, he's had an enormous influence on my career and me personally. And when I was trying to figure out what I want to do after Yahoo, that was about 7 or so years ago, I was in the process of kind of crafting a personal vision statement, and I wanted to bounce it off of Fred. And so we went out to dinner, and I mentioned that based on my experience in the search industry and with the consumer web, that I thought it would be interesting to leverage the power of collective intelligence and innovations on the internet and to help expand the world's collective wisdom. And Fred, in his infinite wisdom, said to me, that's really interesting, but wisdom without compassion is ruthlessness, and compassion without wisdom is folly. And it was one of those moments where literally in real time, you can see a different path opening up. And so you know, at first I asked him who said that, and he said he had just made that up on the spot. I was expecting something
as a good consultant does.
Yeah, I was expecting way more profound. That became, you know, for lack of a better way to describe it, a personal vision statement to expand the world's collective wisdom and compassion. And if you know Fred, that moment is not unusual in the least. The way I describe him is basically the most enlightened person I know within business. And I don't use the expression or the term enlightenment loosely, and it's not really a way I've described anyone else I've worked with. I don't know any other way to describe him or what he does, but when you combine the studied mind of an economist with someone who fully espouses and practices principles of integrity and mindfulness, and you put all that into a business setting as a consultant, it's just absolutely unique. The only other thing I would add is at that same dinner, and this will probably be a segue into some other things that Soren wants to talk about, but that same dinner that night, I was talking to Fred about how one would go about manifesting that vision statement to expand the world's collective wisdom and compassion. And we did a little brainstorming, and Fred had been a consultant for many years working with leaders, trying to figure out how to manifest something similar. And I said, I'd love to be able to figure out a product or a service that one could then put into the marketplace and be able to pursue something like that. And he said, that's challenging. Let me know what you come up with. And a couple months later, I think we circled back, and I said, Fred, I've been racking my brain, and I don't think the answer lies in a product or service. I think the answer may lie in infusing an organization with a leadership team and a culture and a set of values aligned around something on the order of expanding the world's collective wisdom and compassion. And in doing so, perhaps you could build a team and a company that manifests that, and through that energy, it would ultimately be manifested in the products and services that the company brought to market. And sure enough, that's kind of how it's all played out. So 6 years later, we get a chance to work together and help make it a reality.
Wow. And that's the vision that's really inspired you to take the job at LinkedIn, is that correct?
In terms of that, I think in large part, the platform certainly felt like it would be a channel through which I could do good in the world. You know, I had long been interested in education reform since I'm, you know, a young student. And it wasn't until I got to LinkedIn that I realized and understood that education reform and a wonderful education is only one part of the equation. And you could have a wonderful education, but if you don't have access to economic opportunity, yeah, it's incomplete. And so it's interesting the way things worked out, and LinkedIn being a platform to create economic opportunity and then have an opportunity to work with folks like Fred and to bring that to the world and to bring that to fruition. It's a privilege.
Yeah, great. So would you talk a little bit about what your experiments have been so far at LinkedIn and some of the lessons learned? Because it's a beautiful vision and idea, and I think some people would be like, well, what does that look like? Does everybody kind of talk about their feelings all day long? And
that's it. It's all we're doing. How do you feel? I don't know. How do you feel? I'm not sure. How do you feel? It's very productive.
You want to talk about it? Well, we started with a phrase that I did not make up, which is the best way to do is to be. And that was Jeff's vision, that in order to have the moral authority to present this idea to the world and to embody the mission of creating economic opportunity with wisdom and compassion, first, there had to be a leadership team and a culture in the organization that would be that. It wouldn't be just like a statement for consumption outside, but it would be required that people embody that and live that as a day-to-day experience. And how that manifests, for example, is to realize, and this has been a big push in the organization, for people to realize that their job is not their job. So just to give you an example of something very concrete, which is both mindfulness and economics. If you think for a second of how you introduce yourselves and say, you ask each other, what's your job? You will say something like, well, I'm in sales, or I take care of operations, or I look after accounts receivables, or whatever. We use a soccer example. If you ask a defensive player, what's your job? They'll say, well, to stop the other team from scoring. But that's a failure of mindfulness. That's a limited perception. Because if you think of the goal of a team, is to win the game. So the job of every member of the team is to support the team in winning the game, to make the best contribution. But that's not the way people describe their jobs. People say, my job is to, if I use a technical term, to optimize the subsystem that I'm in charge of. But if you study nonlinear optimization in economics, the way to optimize the system is to sub-optimize the subsystems. And this may sound like a mathematical tongue twister, but it really is the fundamental problem of every organization, and it's a problem of economics and mindfulness, that we all experience our reality as the field that is closest to us. And we try to do the best in that limited space, which creates tremendous problems for the larger system. So expanding consciousness and understanding that what I'm here to do is to contribute to the achievement of a noble mission that brings us all together radically changes how you think of your job. And that also radically changes how you do your job, how to connect to other people, how you resolve conflicts. And that has, I mean, that's a very concrete example of mindfulness and economics applied to how an organization can grow and not fall apart, like every large organization falls apart because of fiefdoms. The people just get locked into optimizing their subsystem and they destroy the system. So that would be an example of how mindfulness is lived. It's not touchy-feely, it's not just, tell me how you feel about this. And for people that know economics, this is nonlinear optimization meets agency theory. The latest three Nobel laureates in economics have been on this issue of what creates the limits of the firm and why firms cannot grow beyond a certain stage while becoming like a Russia or a communist economy.
It's in part an issue of perception, if I understand it right, how people perceive themselves and their relationship to others.
Exactly. It's how they conceive themselves, their relationships to others, and their contribution to a larger mission that they're achieving together, in spite of the metrics that through accounting systems will evaluate people through the performance of their small departments in the organization, not the organization as a whole. And that can never be solved without strong leadership from the executives. And that's really what inspired me to join LinkedIn. I thought I was unemployed and unemployable. working like that was out of my picture. And I never saw that kind of drive in a leader to say, we must solve this for LinkedIn, but that will give us the moral authority to present this notion of jobs and economic contribution to the whole world.
That's beautiful, thank you. I'm just gonna take a pause to take that in. The question that comes up, and maybe this is for you, Jeff, is that often what binds a group of people together in a company is increasing profits and increasing net worth. Like, let's all get together and let's grow sales and let's expand and let's get bigger. Is that the energy that you, how do you work with that energy, right? Because most people aren't necessarily motivated about let's have a peaceful culture and let's have a more harmonious culture. There's a kind of a realness to how much, you know, the profits and the whole function of a business. What do you feel the vision is that you're offering your employees that they're getting behind, and how do you balance both the kind of inner element of compassion and wisdom and also the piece on how you're viewed and what your shareholders might think of your company?
Well, for our team, it starts with a sense of purpose. And that's our vision and our mission, where we draw a clear distinction between those two things. So some companies use them synonymously. For us, the vision is our dream. It's true north. It's what inspires us. It's why we come to work every day. And the vision at LinkedIn is to create economic opportunity for every member of the global workforce, all 3 billion plus people. Our mission is an overarching objective, measurable, realizable, hopefully inspirational. That's to connect the world's professionals to make them more productive and successful. And our team is very committed towards not only the realization of the mission, but for the first time in a lot of our careers, we believe we have an opportunity and the potential to manifest our vision, to make our vision a reality by virtue of our scale and our infrastructure and the connections that are being forged. We're now in part measuring our ability to manifest our vision as well. And so there's a sense of purpose that unifies our organization. That's what people want to do. And we can create value for members, we can create value for customers, we can create value for shareholders, we can create value for employees. all in alignment with the realization of the mission and the vision. And you know, sometimes you hear pursuing a purpose or an organization that's purpose-driven, and I think sometimes people will assume it's all about social impact or cause-based. But you heard from a professional economist that that's a mechanism through which you can optimize the performance of an organization and actually be more likely to achieve positive outcomes and generate value. And when you get that kind of alignment at scale across, in our case, thousands of people, it's very powerful.
Right. And I'm curious, so are there other elements that you would say if somebody's out there and they're in a business and it doesn't have that sense of shared purpose and that there's a lot of discord and there's a lot of conflict, what would you say to them that would that you've learned from LinkedIn? Does it have to come from the leadership? And is it simply about inspiring people to a vision?
I would tell them, you're screwed.
You're screwed.
Yes. If they don't have that sense of purpose, I'm sorry, you know, you're in the wrong business. I mean, it's just not going to work. I mean, at some level of scale, you will be like a body rid of cancerous tumors, because every part of the body will try to do the best for itself, and without an integrating mechanism, without a central consciousness that unifies the purpose in a way that people feel proud, they will fly off into all different directions and destroy the organization. They'll compete for limited resources. So this is not like a trivial thing that, oh, we just make a lot of money and we'll be fine. If you really have an organization where people only want to make a lot of money, they will not make a lot of money. They'll destroy the organization.
I would add that it's important that that people recognize the importance of narrative. And a lesson I learned from Deepak Chopra years ago is that we are the stories that we tell. And once that narrative is established and you begin to manifest that, it's amazing how clarifying that can be. And companies are comprised of people. And so companies are the stories that they tell and that their employees tell. And so a vision, a mission, a strategy, a set of value propositions, culture, values, that's a narrative, and that's the story that the company tells. And once you have that in place, if you have the right leadership, if you have the ability to communicate and evangelize effectively, if you have a team of people that are bought into those objectives and aligned around those objectives, when they're all manifesting the narrative together, when that becomes a shared story, it's enormously powerful.
So I have a question. How, you're the number one rated CEO on Glassdoor, at least when I looked a few weeks ago. I think you're the only one with 100%, which Glassdoor lets employees...
Only one way to go from there.
Employees let their... the Glassdoor lets employees rate their CEOs. So what do you think you do besides buying out your employees for a good remark that allows... So it's two-part, that kind of has allowed that to surface. And then how do you deal with people who are really pissed off and really upset and says, like, you talk about this culture and I haven't seen it and I should have gotten that raise or I should have got that advancement, or, you know, this frustration that inevitably comes up as a part of any organization?
Well, for starters, I don't typically put much stock in lists or ranks, but I will say that the fact that that list emanated from the sentiment of our employees was very meaningful. And, you know, I personally believe that leadership is about the ability to inspire others to achieve shared objectives. And I think the most important word there is inspire. And I think that's what separates leaders from managers. Managers tell people what to do, and leaders inspire them to do it. And I think inspiration largely emanates from three dimensions. The first is the clarity of your vision and what mountain you're trying to summit and climb. And the second is the courage of your conviction, because if you have true vision and you want to try something that hasn't been done before, there's going to be a lot of naysayers, there's going to be a lot of skeptics, there's going to be a lot of people who feel threatened and try to get in your way. And you have to feel it deeply to be able to overcome those challenges and for people to want to follow you. And if you're not authentic in that belief and you don't have true conviction, they're not going to be behind you. And then lastly is the ability to effectively communicate that vision and that conviction. And I think if leaders are in a position where they can do those three things, that they can effectively inspire. And when you can inspire, it's just a matter of what objective you're trying to achieve, and then ensuring that you're surrounding yourself with the absolute best talent you can to make it a reality.
Right. Okay. And
I'd like to use a metaphor.
Can we come back to how you deal with people who are pissed off?
Sure. So, is there a specific context when you say?
We hear all this stuff about wisdom and compassion at LinkedIn, and I'm frustrated. I feel like I was mistreated. I feel like I should have gotten that raise. I should have gotten that promotion.
Yep.
I see so-and-so advancing. Just the stuff that comes up.
Sure. You mean day-to-day?
Day-to-day.
Human interaction.
Day-to-day human desire systems conflicting.
Yeah. So, my first principle of leadership and management is compassionate management. And that starts with putting yourself in the shoes of the person that you're engaging with. And you're using the example of someone that's quote-unquote pissed off. Something's bothering them. And I think more often than not, when we're sitting across the table from someone who's bringing that kind of energy, your or anyone's knee-jerk reaction is to become defensive or equally frustrated or angry, maybe anxious, as opposed to taking a moment to understand where that person's coming from. And more often than not, if we can become spectators to our own thoughts in those moments, especially when we become emotional, we'll recognize that they may be triggering something in us. And then you get involved in this very vicious cycle where they're angry, you're angry, and you're not being rational per se, you're not being logical, you're not trying to win, you're not trying to achieve a shared sense of purpose. It's just about being right and getting your point across. And if we can all take a moment in those situations to understand where the other person's coming from and recognizing that perhaps they don't have any nefarious intention whatsoever, but maybe they're having a bad day. Maybe they have some baggage that got triggered for whatever reason. Maybe they don't understand what you're talking about and they are anxious or embarrassed. Maybe you remind them of something that happened previously. Who knows? But if you can take a moment to recognize that those may be the causes of the behavior, you can do something about it. And you can connect with that person in a way where you are going to achieve the right outcome. And I think that's an essential part of the way we manage at the company, is managing compassionately.
Fred, did you want to add?
I wanted to say a couple of things. One, again, to dispel this notion of touchy-feeliness, of mindfulness. What Jeff just described is the principle of mindfulness, of having to be nobody because you can be anybody. So becoming a spectator to one's own thoughts is the practice of the witness consciousness, and that's like going to the gym. So I'll let Jeff speak about his meditation practice, but certainly I think it's an essential part of compassion to be able to step out of the drive that is telling us I'm right and they're wrong, and I can just see that impulse as, oh, this is not mine. I am in a position of being nobody. I can be me. It's one of the anybodies, but I can also be you, and there's no privileged position from which to see the situation. That's the essence of mindfulness as I see it, and it has tremendous impact on the hardest conversations in day-to-day work. And the other thing that Jeff didn't say, but I think is extremely important in his capacity to inspire people, and it has to do with how to wield power. I worked for 25 years in business, and I see a lot of leaders that I see as rowing like a little boat, and they're bringing everybody along and say, come follow me. And the way I've seen Jeff, and I see other great leaders, is they'll go get on a surfboard and catch a maverick. I mean, they'll get on a huge wave. And they don't say, follow me. They're saying, come on this huge wave, this beautiful vision of how we can create economic opportunity in the world, how we can connect the professionals so they can be more productive and successful. And I just inspired to tears, saying, my God, this is so beautiful. I want to participate in an effort like this. And even though it's expressed through a person, and I think people connect to a person that manifests this vision, over and over, I mean, I see Jeff saying, this is our vision, and nobody's following me. So paradoxically, the ability to disengage from this first-person attachment that it's me, creates a much more compelling case to be a manifestation of this vision. And I do see Jeff surfing a Maverick, and all of us, you know, surfing the same Maverick, but not following him. This is, I mean, in a sense, he works for us. I mean, I say this in LinkedIn, Jeff works for us. He's, I mean, in a sense, he's our boss, but he's also the person that we use to express our vision. So I'm not working for him or LinkedIn. LinkedIn is working for us because we are there to express a desire and a purpose that we could not manifest on our own. And we're affiliated and associated in the pursuit of that beautiful purpose.
How do you see it, Jeff? Because I feel like from one level, we have these identities, right? Well, I'm the manager, I'm the boss, I'm the this. But also, I'm an employee at LinkedIn is also yet another identity. Or I'm a LinkedIn person, right? So we walk around as we think a LinkedIn person should walk around. So there's... I have no idea.
What is a LinkedIn person? Can you do the LinkedIn walk? That look like?
It's like a walk, but forward.
Well, you know, you either say it with a lot of pride or you say it with less pride. Yeah. And it feels like what you guys are trying to do is both not just transform LinkedIn, but it feels like you have a bigger vision. I'd love to hear what you see as the potential for business and the potential for really inspiring something kind of beyond the example that I think you're doing there.
So there's two ways to answer that. One is specifically how we would bring the vision to life through the platform, and the other is how we're doing business. So with regard to the vision and the manifestation of the vision of creating economic opportunity for every member of the global workforce, we believe we're in a very unique position to do something that hasn't been done before, which is to develop the world's first economic graph, which would essentially be a digital mapping of the global economy. So imagine a profile where today we're at about 347 million members. There's about 780 million knowledge workers and students in the world, which is our immediate addressable opportunity in the mission statement I described, but there's over 3 billion people in the global workforce. So imagine a profile, a digital profile for every one of those people, every one of those 3 billion people in the global workforce. One, two, a digital profile for every company in the world. There's on the order of 60 to 70 million companies in the world when you include small and medium-sized businesses. Three, a digital representation of every job availability in the world, full-time, part-time, for-profit, and volunteer, on the order of 10 to 20 million of those. A digital representation for every skill required to obtain one of those opportunities and jobs. A digital representation or profile for every higher educational organization or university that would enable an individual to acquire the skills to get those jobs. And then to make it easy for every individual, every company, and every university to share their professionally relevant knowledge with the rest of the world. And then we would take a step back and allow capital, all forms of capital, intellectual capital, working capital, and human capital, to flow to where it could best be leveraged. And in doing so, the hope is that we can help lift and transform the global economy and enable every individual in that global workforce to successfully navigate the 21st century economy, control their own destiny. So that's how we see the vision coming to life and the power of that and the value we could create for people. In terms of the way in which we do business and how that can impact people, it kind of goes back to the anecdote I mentioned earlier about if you want to expand the world's collective wisdom and compassion, do you do that by selling a specific product, like wisdom and compassion in a box?
I've been thinking about that.
Or you, yeah. That's what he's doing right
There's
now.
Actually, something.
So you could literally sell that. And what's interesting is that when Soren and I first met, and he shared with me the mission for this entity, for this event, it struck me that there are ways of bringing products and services to market to do it. And this is an example of that. An application like Headspace, a fantastic application for those interested in learning how to meditate, is another example. And I think this is a sign of our times. I think, you know, years ago, it would have been more challenging to do something like that by virtue of products and services. And that was when Fred and I formulated this thesis that perhaps it's best to start by building an organization that practices the expansion of wisdom and compassion through its culture and values. And then if you're hiring the right people and you're providing them the right development tools, you could potentially be grooming the next generation of leaders who would seek to do that regardless of what company they were a part of and what product or service they brought to market.
And it'd be infused inevitably versus having this idea that you're selling something.
That's
but
right.
It's not embodied.
It's manifested through the way you do business as opposed to the specific products or services. So I don't think those are mutually exclusive. And then, interestingly enough, it's funny the way things work out, but one of the cornerstones of the LinkedIn platform is our publishing platform, which enables any member of LinkedIn to share their professionally relevant information, knowledge, expertise, et cetera. And one of the things that Fred and I were very excited about in terms of the model we're creating at LinkedIn is when Fred shares some of his wisdom, either that he developed over time in his leadership development capacity at a firm that he used to work in, or if he's developing it somewhat extemporaneously at LinkedIn in real time through our team, he would then be in a position where he could share it with the world through the platform. And that was very important to him in terms of his vision for the role he played in the world. And it was a complete natural, it was a perfect fit for us. Yeah. And so rather than want to hold on to that information, I'm always encouraging him, you know, we all are, that's a post. Did you post that yet? Get that out there. Because everyone benefits from it.
So one of my friends, I think he might be here, Loic Lemire, you know, he used to post a lot on technology, and he got into meditation, he's posting more on meditation, and he says his posts on meditation are hugely much more popular than ever once has ever were on technology. And I'm wondering if you also see that trend, and what is it that you think is drawing people more to something kind of that might 10 years ago have seen as impractical and wooey, whether it's compassion or meditation or some of this other inner dimension?
Well, as Richard said in the previous talk he gave, today science has demonstrated very clearly that meditation is like health, and going to the gym was 20 years ago. So we're at the cusp when something is about to radically shift, because now with the MRIs and other instruments, we can understand how brain reacts to mental and mind exercise and how that influences a person's life, their physical life, so with the quantitative measures of science. So I think there's a growing excitement in everybody who's alive and wants to be productive and wants to do better and be happy in life to find better and better tools. And the new tool, the new thing that everybody's like finding infinite richness in and infinite wealth is meditation and mindfulness. So I mean, John Kabat-Zinn has been advocating for 30 years how important that was for health. And although he had the results to prove it, we couldn't just get into people's brains and see it the way we can see it now. Now, all these years and all this background of data with scientists like Richard are coming to the fore and saying, hey, no, this is the new thing. And business will be right there to massify it. I mean, things will become massive when they become part of business. And, you know, I don't need to prove the point when every business believes that that's the way to be productive and to make more money. Ultimately, that desire for self-interest will help contribute to the growth in society that was nobody's plan. And this is what Adam Smith said, you know, when people pursue their self-interest, if they do it intelligently, they contribute to a benefit to humanity that they didn't plan, but accrues because truth will emerge from that wise desire for helping others, which is the basis of any market.
Through following that self-interest, skillfully, you said.
Yes.
And Jeff, how do you think people see you? You ever get people coming up and be like, what's this kind of weird compassionate management stuff? And you guys are a little out there, or how are you perceived, or how are your relationships with other CEOs in terms of these kinds of conversations? Are they had at all?
So there are a few different constituents in there in the question. So with regard to the people approaching me, I think you may be surprised by how many people are interested. Well, you wouldn't be surprised given what you do for a living, but one might be surprised at the number of people who are genuinely interested in learning more about compassionate management, understanding how it can make a difference in their day-to-day life, how to best practice it, why it works. And, you know, if at one point that was considered within the realm of new age practices, that's no longer the case. You know, just as Fred had mentioned, that the science behind mindfulness and meditation is at this point largely irrefutable. There's also an increasing body of work on practices within the workplace that are closely tied to the creation of long-term shareholder value. And these kinds of mindful practices and managing compassionately and the expression of gratitude and having a strong sense of purpose, having a strong sense of self-identity as an organization, it works. So with regard to the question about CEOs, I think a lot of people would be very surprised at, in particular within Silicon Valley, the number of CEOs increasingly embracing both mindfulness and compassion as a management practice.
And do you think that's just because of the science and there's a new wave coming up, or do you think there's, how do you see the
it's next? It's a great question. Well, so I hadn't thought of that before, but two things immediately came to mind. One, yes, I do think CEOs tend to be data-driven in terms of empirical knowledge and support for a thesis, and I think there's more science, to Fred's point earlier, than really ever before. I also think, to a large extent, that people in their day-to-day practice see the results. They see the benefits, and I think they know it works, so they continue to practice it.
How about you, Fred?
I don't think it's weird anymore.
I think for me, often the challenge is like, how do I be compassionate and then also strong? And I think there's been this notion for a while that existed that compassion means softness, means giving in to let the other person have their way. So they have this choice. Either I have to kind of be a hard ass, or I have to be liked. And I think I'd love for you to say a little bit about the difference between being liked and being a compassionate manager. Because I think at least for a lot of men, there's a resistance to that. It's just like, I want to be strong. I don't want to be like the nice guy that everybody walks over.
Okay. This has been, I mean, this is a very powerful question and a misperception that has to do with how wide your compassion, your circle of compassion is. Because being nice, it's an excuse. It's a very small, like, I want to be compassionate because I want to look good. And that's not real compassion. But thinking about all the people that will be impacted by accepting anything less than excellence, our mission is so significant. I mean, just to take it out of LinkedIn, if we were doctors and we were talking about a mediocre doctor that has a high casualty rate, but he's such a nice guy, and you know, we need to keep him around, and his kids are in school, and you know, poor thing, and you know, what about the families of the people that die? What about the people that don't get the best care? So, what is compassion? How wide your circle of compassion is, and how tough you could be with demanding excellence for the sake of the vision, for the sake of the larger purpose that brings us together. And I've seen Jeff be absolutely masterful in navigating this apparent dilemma by referring back to the vision. So, and I really see that there's no conflict when you extend your circle of compassion wide enough.
Okay. One of the most common questions I get on the subject of managing compassionately is somewhat consistent with Fred's anecdote, which is, you talk a lot about compassion, but then how do you handle a situation when you need to let someone go? I mean, if you're being compassionate, you would never do that, right? And it's literally the exact opposite. And it's hard. And I guess there's a form of toughness. I mean, for those that think being compassionate is being soft or allowing yourself to get stepped on, it's dealing with really profoundly difficult situations where you are doing whatever you can to alleviate somebody else's suffering. And it's hard. And so one of the most common questions I get is, I find it easy to be compassionate with people I like, but what do you do with the people that you don't like? And compassion is not conditional. And the practice of unconditional compassion, it's really, really challenging. I mean, to be sitting across from that person that you know you don't...
Wrong.
or how about that does not share your values? You're coming at it from a different perspective, or you don't necessarily appreciate the way that they're treating other people. I mean, to put yourself in that person's shoes, to see the world through their lens, to try to help them, despite the fact that you may not care for them or like them, that requires strength. That's the exact opposite of some of that softness that I think is all too often associated with compassion.
We just have another minute or two left. Yeah, thanks. Is there a question you want to answer that I didn't ask?
Yeah. Well, you didn't ask when have I seen Jeff at his best.
Okay, Fred, how do you see Jeff at your best?
Was this a performance review all of a sudden?
Yeah. No, there was an event in Los Angeles called Global Sales Kickoff that I hadn't been to such a big event before. It was about 3,000 people in a huge auditorium where the Emmy Awards, I think, are given. And Jeff was doing like a fireside chat. And as they were speaking, and then somebody asked him about his strategy for karaoke.
Oh.
There is a strategy for karaoke.
He has a very well-defined strategy.
In case you're interested.
But that wasn't so moving. But the fact is that... He started singing.
Singing?
Singing, yes.
I was practicing, exemplifying.
Exemplifying the
how
strategy.
One would
leading
that
by example.
To life. What's
and,
that?
But the thing that was shocking was the 3,000 people who were there, the salespeople, started singing with him. I have never seen that. I started crying. I was sitting there. And I was crying because it takes, this is not something you can ask. This is not something it emerged spontaneously. And it wasn't the quality of the song. It was just the...
or my voice.
Yeah. I'm not sucking up to him. You know, it wasn't that. But it was, it's what it said about the culture of LinkedIn, that could happen, that people would just break in song, having fun and enjoying being together, led in a way that was, there was no leadership. It was an invitation for everybody to sing. And that was very touching for me. And I really felt moved. I told Jeff, I wrote him an email afterwards, but it's one of the things that I remember forever. It was
that he was willing to sing in front of...
No, that 3,000 people were willing to sing with him. It wasn't just his sing. Yeah, and that there exists a culture where that would be possible. So it wasn't just the
that
moment,
would be supported.
But it's what needed to happen before for that moment to be possible.
Okay. How about you, Jeff? Anything that you were not asked that you'd like to share or to break in song?
You want to know the three rules of good karaoke? No. Do you really? No. All right, I guess wisdom 2.0. I'm sharing karaoke.
Yeah. Share your wisdom, please.
All forms.
Okay, so first, I can't believe we're going to do it. So most people, when they have an opportunity to sing karaoke, are going to knee-jerk to their favorite songs. Your favorite songs are sung by some of the best recording artists of all time. If you were a really good singer like those folks, you'd be doing that for a living. So just bear that in mind. So some folks you want to steer clear of, Freddie Mercury, Queen, don't go there. Elton John, Bon Jovi, Journey. I mean, these guys can sing. So, Beyonce, Aretha, please. All right. So that's first.
Leave it alone.
So don't just knee-jerk to your favorite songs. Give it a little bit of thought. So when it comes to the thought, at least for the guys, I'm speaking for the guys now, you want to pick something that's a little lower in the register, and you don't want to find yourself going up and up and up, because at some point it's going to end very badly. Similarly, slower tempoed songs are going to be a little easier to do than the faster songs. So faster high pitch, not so good. Slower, lower pitch, a little bit better. Third rule, by far and away the most important thing, is it's really not about the quality of your voice. It's about the energy, like any effective public speaking. So you want to make sure people are having a good time. So pick something that everyone can sing along with. And the most important corollary to that is when everyone in the audience starts singing, they can't hear you. That's it.
So I'm just going to wait a moment. I'm just going to wait a moment. And if there's something that wants to show up from either of you, there's absolutely no pressure.
There's three songs that I think score very highly along the algorithm. So the first is Sweet Caroline, which is my go-to.
Okay.
The second is Lean on Me, which is what we performed there. Yeah. And the third is Sitting on the Dock of the Bay.
Oh, that's nice.
So given we're here in the Bay Area. No.
Sure can.
You're not going to hear yourself.
Oh, God.
Will there be a few people who will sing along?
I can't sing.
Okay.
All right.
They'll sing with you.
This isn't going to show up on the internet.
We don't know.
No.
Sitting in the morning sun. And I'll be sitting till the evening comes. Watching the ships roll in. And I'll watch them roll away again. Oh, I'm sitting on the dock of the bay. Watching the tide roll away. Sitting on the dock of the bay. Wasting time.
There you go.
Woo! So I want to thank Jeff and Fred for joining us again and sharing your wisdom and your inspiration and your leadership. And I know all of us are touched by it and are eager to go back into our own worlds and to experiment even more deeply about what this means. Thank you.
With all of that and a new karaoke
algorithm. New karaoke system.